Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. It's very demanding teaching which we just heard from Jesus. Love enemies, do good to those who hate you, and so on. But before you go to this direction, which we obviously need grace, blessings of God to do it, I wanted to point something else, which is much more practical and much more everyday use. The difference between giving or giving in. You don't have to remember everything. This is one of these classical books, Healing Wounded Emotions by Martin Padovani. It's a book at least 25, 30 years old, still on the market, still on Amazon, you can get it. It's very useful to know about the psychology of us, which can support our faith, which can block our faith, or you can use even the things which are difficult to your own advantage by making the right decision. Giving is woven into daily living and important part of relating to others. And we need to define what we mean by it and be more aware of it, what is happening inside you. We may give someone a book, a ride, a pleasant glance, a dollar, a meal, or a helping hand. On the emotional level, we may give ourselves to others, and such giving expresses who we are, what we think, how we feel, and dependent on the richness of your personality, you might extend it even more. In our closer relationships, emotional giving becomes a much more sensitive, much more intense, and more complicated part of relating to others. The emotions can support, they can block. Don't allow to be blocked by emotions. It involves not only a deeper level of sharing through communication, but also a deeper level of commitment. And when we're coming to commitment, it's always demanding because you have to sacrifice something which is not easy, and that's why it's also precious commitment, because it's not easy. Within this area, there are two types of giving. One is the self-giving, is very positive. The other is giving in. It's obviously a negative. So the act of self-giving is an act of love. And it's primarily an act of the will, a decision, a choice. There can be an abundance of more tender feelings involved in self-giving, or there can be no feelings at all, or even negative feelings. Don't be taken by the feelings. You cannot change them, but you can make a decision. And this is what really counts. This is what is really important. In the last analysis, with or without feelings, self-giving is still a valid and good act. As you are sitting in the church, you might have good feelings, warm feelings, or you might be rebellious. You might have something surprising happening in you. What will you do? See on the common sense. Which prayer is more precious in the eyes of God? This sweet, easy, nothing costing? Or when you are fighting to be present, when you are fighting to be truthful and cooperating with the grace of God? It's obviously the second one, more precious in the eyes of God, because they're trying to be true to Him. And even if the feelings are rebellious against everything what is in you, you can still make a good decision. Sometimes we naively think that when we give of ourselves, it is genuine only when we have positive feelings. And this type of thinking leads us into trouble, because it's not true. The end result is important, not how you came to this result, meaning, of course, good means. When it is devoid of such feelings or even accompanied by negative feelings, it is a much more genuine act. And it's difficult because it demands some kind of action, some kind of sacrifice of us. Giving without any warm feelings has to be based on a deep, sincere conviction. And in other words, it's a deeper act of love. because it costs more. It demands more of you. And if you make this decision, act against your feelings, that's how it's precious. The mother might have a sleepless night nursing the little baby for her night, and sure, she has no great feelings. But she does it, and that's this love so counts, because it's self-sacrificial for the benefit of this little baby. A gospel story illustrates this point very well, this parable of the two sons. A father asked these two sons to go out into the vineyard to work. The first says, "No, I will not go there," the rebellious one. The second one, "Of course I'm going." He never appeared. So in the long run, the first son went unwillingly, grumbling, but he went to the vineyard and he was working there. But the other, so nice, polite personality, he never showed up in the vineyard. I was complaining about my rebellious nature, that is somehow disadvantage being born with this rebellious nature. But in fact, if you look on the teaching of the gospel, it's not really disadvantage to be this Mr. No or Mrs. No or anything like this. What do you do with this later? Are you thinking it over, praying it over? Because Jesus asked this question, which one did the will of the Father? And the answer is obvious, the one who went to the vineyard. So see how it appears in you and read it correctly in you. If a wife asks her husband to go shopping with her and he manifests some unwillingness but then says, "For you, I'll do it." You know, she might make, you know, this reaction. She may be irritated with him and say, "Since that's the way you feel, don't bother." You know, she's killing the good intention. In other words, if he doesn't have the accompanying positive feelings, his gesture of goodwill, the good decision, is tossed aside. It doesn't make sense, does it? Just see it in correct light. We continue to promote this erroneous thinking that self-giving is invalid or somehow count for less unless accompanied by cheerful, positive feelings and attitudes. So what is the meaning of the guy who is always saying, "Yes, yes, of course," and doing nothing? Positive feelings, no action. In any basic commitment, we look for these very precious things: conviction, dedication, consistency, and loyalty. This is very much required and in good price. But if you see carefully, none of these characteristics requires positive, warm feelings to put the commitment into effect. We are not machines that you can be programmed, you know, with good feelings. Somehow discover unpleasant feelings in you. So what will you do? No, first of all, rid them and overpower them by your decision. Love is just as strong and even stronger when we give ourselves to another without accompanying good feelings, as it is when we give with warm enthusiasm. Any kind of service, even sitting here in the church. So because our feelings are inconsistent and not under our control, total control, we can't allow them to govern our self-giving. Commitments subject to feelings would not last because the feelings wouldn't last. Look how the country's functioning. You cannot build anything on the feelings. Use them for your advantage by the right decision. However, if I consistently lack warm feelings towards another, I would do well to closely examine my relationship. There may be unresolved negative feelings in me that needs to be looked at. You can use the priest, you can go to the counselor, you can talk to the psychotherapist, whoever is available for you, whoever can help. But generally, on a daily basis, you can solve it yourself. It's in the gospel again. Time and again, Jesus returns to the theme that he has come to do the Father's will. His ultimate giving was his suffering. It was his death. It was this terrifying death on the cross. So in Jesus' willingness to give of himself to bring us salvation, he also experienced hesitation, fear. He was sweating with blood. And he was praying the words which we know by heart, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass me by. Yet not my, but yours be done. So this is one of the perfect examples what God expects from us. He's the ultimate act of giving without positive feelings. But he did something more. Jesus' self-giving came from a deep sense of commitment, conviction, dedication, and loyalty to his Father. That's why he was sent to bring salvation. And whatever it costs, I will do it. Overpowering feelings, shaping them by the decision. One of the characteristics of a genuine self-giving, as difficult as it may be at times, is a subsequent deep sense of satisfaction and peace in your heart. Nobody can see it, but you know exactly what is happening. You might do something for your family, for your children. They will not even say thank you. They will accuse you that you did nothing. But you know what was the way of doing. And this satisfaction of fulfillment of doing your duty, doing much more for God than for them, it stays. It lasts. And it's very precious. This far surpasses the pleasing feelings that may or may not be present in the doing of the deed. So once more, you have to know yourself. You have to observe what is happening in you because no one else can know it until you communicate. From our external demeanor, no one would deduce the inner struggle we may be experiencing. And that's why if you don't communicate, the other people might not read you correctly at all. But that's maturity. That's love. If you overcome all these limitations, all these influences, and then still do what is right, what should be done. So we need to remove unrealistic and idealistic notions about giving that must be accompanied by good feelings, or we shortchange ourselves and create unnecessary problems. Just to give you some personal example, my second assignment as a priest was obviously collaboration between the bishop and the pastor who wanted to take me to this parish. It was a very good parish. It was in some way promotion, but I hated what was behind my back. And then I came with this attitude that each appointment I was already disappointed before even I went there. And then once I recognized it that I'm going angry to this new appointment, and then for next 2 years or 3 years I'm talking about my last appointment, which was so good and so many good things happened there. So I got it when I got new assignment in Africa. Why I have to be grumpy? Why I have to be unhappy? Why I cannot come being opened? You don't have to have even positive feelings. Just be open. Take what is coming. And it was a whole change and transition much more easy. The decision, observing yourself and making the right decision. However, when we speak of giving in, that's an entirely different meaning. Giving in is a negative act. That's beyond any discussion. It connotes resentment, hostile resistance, being forced to do something we are unwilling to do. And giving in is wrong reaction to life. Such pressure can come from another person or from within ourselves. And we may be acting out of fear of unpleasant consequences that may occur if we don't give in. Wrong choice. It is important to recognize the difference and not confuse the two so we can keep the nature of our close relationship clear in our minds. Often, others can't recognize how we really think and feel, but you know it. The question is always how to deal with it. One of the great things in the church is the example of the saints. Saint Margaret Mary, the one from this merciful open heart of Jesus, very, very famous in our Catholic tradition, she was a nun and she was seeing Jesus and she was rebellious. And she was irritated with her own rebellion. I don't even know why I'm rebellious. Yeah. So she asked Jesus on one occasion to remove it. And he, as usual, he doesn't remove. But he gave her a way how to overcome rebellion. Hide with your rebellion in my pierced heart. That's how the saints are dealing with this. And it was his advice, and until you try to do it, you will never know what I'm talking about. Immediately, as I read it, immediately I switched off the conference and, okay, let me put my rebellion to the heart of Jesus, see what is happening to this rebellious heart. Sometimes a willingness to give with a certain grumbling might be interpreted as implying negative resistance or resentment in the giver, while a smiling yes might mask underlying hostility and resentment. And from outside, nobody can really know what is in your mind, what is in your heart, unless you tell them. But you know, and learn how to read it correctly. This is likely to occur when marital or family communication is not open and honest. They are not really aware of what's happening in the other. They are playing games instead of being honest. This leads not only to disturbed individuals, but to troubled relationships. Just listen, don't presume, don't guess what they think, what they want. Talk. It's better than shouting, than presuming and not really knowing what is happening to the other person. This may explain why long after the childhood years, an adult harbors deep resentment towards a parent who is either unaware of it or, if aware, is baffled by it. Where the communication failed, something was wrong. Or this may explain why a spouse just walks out of seemingly good marriage. Happens. Piled up resentment has come to the surface, much of it the result of the departing spouse having given in for years, but never talking about it. It's wrong choice, it's devastating choice. Giving in sabotages intimacy and leads to a false, superficial closeness. Aren't they a loving couple? If they are a really loving couple, there is a cross, and sometimes one of the spouses carries a bigger part of this cross. Nothing good comes easy. That's why good is so precious. Often, though, this ideal couple have a relationship that is not genuine and is in serious trouble. Such spouses never indicated how they felt, nor were they able to convert giving in into giving. God gave us the feelings which can support, which can block, but you have the power by the decision to identify it and turning giving in into giving. To glorify God, to say thank you for His graces. Parents are delighted to have a docile, quiet child, but very often this quiet child is not a normal and secure child, but one who hides behind a deep need of acceptance at the price of conforming and pleasing at any cost. And resentment piles up unnecessarily. Giving in so as to be accepted may be a temporary solution to a problem. Keeping quiet, it never works. In the long run, such peace and conformity at any price is not only dishonest, because you are somehow lying, but creates emotional conflicts within the individual and eventually sabotages relationships, destroys their relationships. So looking from the Bible, somewhere in life we all have to come to grips with the matter of giving in. It's not what you want, it's not what you wanted, it's a side effect of the original sin. You can just go to the first basic Genesis story. Eve gave in to the serpent, Adam gave in to Eve. Just as the very beginning when they lost their relationship with God. We all suffer from these disastrous results, and somehow each of us has to be able to recognize the difference between giving in and giving. From outside, might nobody see it, but from inside, you should know it and be able to make distinction between giving in and giving, transforming giving in into giving. If resentment is not recognized a greater danger to good relationships occurs, and it's quite expected, since the pattern of giving in can be as natural as breathing, so it could be masked. It requires a conscious effort on our part to know what is going on within us at all times. That's what is necessary to know yourself, and it helps. Sometimes we shall have to express our resentment at having to give in so that the other person can read us correctly, so that we can both go on living, being tolerant with each other or compromising or disagreeing. But at least you know what is happening in this other person. So once more, communication, talking is so important. At least the problem has surfaced if you talk. You are no longer playing games with each other, you are not pretending. So such a transformation involves the individual's ability through motivation or maturity to change attitudes. Try. Don't start with the most difficult, start with seemingly easiest. And see what kind of amazing skills, power God gave us by making a decision, right decision. The husband who grumbled about going shopping with his wife, but says, "But for you, dear, I'll do it," has transformed giving in into giving. And see how he was rewarded. Our teens have to learn how to do this as they grow up, or they will remain immature adults. I'm going to mass not because I feel like it or because you drag me, threaten me, ground me or whatever. I choose a sense of religious responsibility, and you can make the choice. And eventually the feelings, the negative feelings, they will go away. You might be somehow proud of this power which God gave to us. Be aware, use it. That's an important step towards maturity. Dealing with our obvious or hidden mechanism of giving in is part of emotional and spiritual growth. Be aware of it. Do it. The ability to distinguish between giving in and giving can make a significant difference in the type of person we become, in the type of relationships we form. And if you overcome all these feelings imposing themselves on us, you might be different person. Total consciousness of this is somehow not possible, but we must be in touch with our inner world as much as possible. To identify, to catch yourself on giving in is already progress. And to solve the problem, we have to transform giving in into giving. No one else can do it for you. You can only see it in yourself, and you can make the right decision. That also works, another example, Brother Rowland and St. Lawrence of the Resurrection. Is it not quicker and easier just to do our common business wholly for the love of Him? Anything, as much as unpleasant, could be imposed on you. You can always turn to glorify God. It's up to you. And in the end, that is basically the distinction each one of us has to make. Giving to God, asking for His support, for His blessing, and enjoy when you overcome something what blocks you, or if something what blocks you, you turn into your own advantage.